Hello, I'm Sean O'Connell, Managing Director at Cinema Blend and co-host of the Real Blend podcast, and I'm here tonight to introduce you to an action-packed documentary that's all about George Miller's Mad Max Fury Road. We are currently in an age where franchises are getting rebooted all of the time by major studios that have to take old properties off of the shelf. It might be Blade Runner 2049, or even Danny Boyle returning to the Trainspotting genre, but none of those films could prepare us for what we got out of George Miller when he went back to the Mad Max franchise for Fury Road. Essentially, this is a wall-to-wall car chase that is filled with some of the most incredible practical effects that you've ever seen committed to screen. And it's kind of mesmerizing that George Miller, 40 years into his director's career, managed to put together something that's as gonzo and unpredictable and eye-popping as some of the things that we see in Mad Max Fury Road. His vision of the apocalyptic future somehow still manages to build off of what we saw in the previous Mad Max films, but they are amplified through a prism that speaks to modern audiences and really takes what they expect to see from their blockbusters and really ratchets it up to 11. It's to the point where when you see a guy playing a guitar that shoots flames out of the top of it, it's not that overwhelming. It kind of fits into the vision that George Miller is painting with Mad Max Fury Road, and kind of something that we'd expect to see from this franchise as it makes its way to a fourth film. Now, Tom Hardy was a suitable replacement for original Mad Max star Mel Gibson, but I think what audiences walked away from Fury Road raving about was a Charlize Theron's character, Furiosa, and that's somebody who I really hope we get to spend more time with in future films. For those of us who joined us last night, we're gonna do something similar to the way we did with Martin Scorsese, in that we're gonna head over to Twitter right now and keep the conversation going during the documentary. Myself and my Real Blend co-stars, Kevin McCarthy and Jake Hamilton, will be using the hashtag WBFilmmakers as we talk about all things George Miller and Mad Max Fury Road. So make sure you use that hashtag to keep up with our conversation and join in. So now, without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to the documentary Going Mad, The Battle of Fury Road, so we can learn how George Miller put this amazing film together.
When you make a film, it's a little bit like a military campaign. You lay out all your plans, you put your team or army together, and then you go out into the field of battle. Filmmaking is creative warfare. We're in a world now where we've got so much information. There's so much data coming at us. We are utterly overwhelmed by it. So you're looking for a signal in the noise. You're looking for something that feels coherent in all that bombardment. And I think we do that through stories. For better or for worse, stories help us find our way through that. Creativity is really interesting because it's so paradoxical in so many ways. On the one hand, there's a lot of craft and rigor in it, and on the other hand, there's complete sort of surrender to any idea. When a really great idea or really great solution arrives, it's unmistakable. Ah, that's what we're looking for. I don't know exactly where, but I was walking across a pedestrian crossing, and halfway across the crossing, an idea came into my head. You can tell a Mad Max movie in which it was a continuous chase. At the same time, the notion was that there would be a number of women and that they would have a female road warrior who was helping them escape. And by the time I got to the other side of the road, I said, no, I'll put it aside. And then I was on a plane This is probably 2 years after that initial thought. It was a late night flight from Los Angeles to Sydney, flying over the Pacific. And a good two-thirds of the story played out in my mind about what would happen, where this woman would be from. It was very important that Max get caught up in the story. What was Max's circumstance? What was the world, who the tyrant was? And I got really excited. It just kept sort of tumbling out. I remember it landing in Sydney, and when I saw Doug Mitchell, I said, look, I think there's another Mad Max movie.
George wanted to make the film wall-to-wall action from one end to the other. And he'd thought a lot about it, as he always does, and decided that the only real way for him to do that was to draw the story.
This is a room in the middle of the Art Deco building, which we've been working in for 30 years. It's a large room, and basically we call it the Mad Max room, because it was here where Brendan McCarthy and I sat down for the first time and talked out the story and then quickly drafted it in prose form. You know, he said, I'm here to make sure that you don't screw up the next Mad Max movie. He said that quite without any irony or whatever.
George calls me the sort of the guardian of Mad Max, in a way. After Road Warrior, Thunderdome was great, but I felt a bit disappointed, and I felt that it didn't quite do what I was hoping for. I think the essence of a Mad Max film is the sort of, you know, there's the Joseph Campbell mythological stuff, but there's also Demolition Derby, you know, there's that side of it as well. I remember a critic once talking about Mad Max 2 saying, talking about the delight in destruction in the film. And I thought, yeah, you know when a little boy has got a toy and he's going, there's that element in George's work that I think I want to keep that.
So Peter Pound and Mark Sexton, two wonderful storyboard artists, joined us. And it was here where we actually laid out the film in its first proper iteration as an extended storyboard.
Through that course of 2 years, we were slowly surrounded by more and more storyboards.
3,500 panels all around this room, up on boards, and you could walk around the room virtually and play out the movie.
You'd walk past this room, and then months later you walk past the room, they're still there. You'd feed them pizzas under the door and throw the hose in to kind of wash them down.
It was a series of experimentations visually to try and get the best story we possibly could.
Mel heard about the project and said, I'm interested in doing it. Brendan was the one who kept on saying, you can't do it without Mel. So Mel was going to do it, and this was, I think, in the year 2000, somewhere there. And Mel had his deal at Fox, and so we started to talk about doing it at Fox.
George had basically decided that his idea for a location brief, which was the next move, was that it should be dead flat and completely blank and have no vegetation, nothing.
We looked all over for the location. Colin went to the Great Salt Lakes in Bolivia. He went to Chile, they went to China, they went to Mexico.
Kazakhstan and Jordan and Dubai, pretty much anywhere that had three-fifths of fuck all. And I was lucky enough to find Namibia. Got off the plane, rented a four-wheel drive, and I think within half an hour I'd decided this was definitely the spot. And so I went over with a small crew, set up a workshop, started building.
never quite sealed off all the deals, but they were well on their way. Then 9/11 happened. The American dollar dropped by 25% against the Australian dollar. So within 2 or 3 days, we lost almost a quarter of our budget. There's no way we could adjust the script in time to even, you know, attempt to make the movie.
I got a phone call saying, please stop spending money. Now! And I did.
It was an incredibly depressing time because we were over there, all the vehicles were ready to go.
The truth is, by now, it's fallen apart. It's irretrievably fallen apart. So we have to wrap and destroy the vehicles. We don't want them ripped off. It must have been a thankless task for Colin, who, you know, again, had spent all this creative energy and, you know, we were always working on tight deadlines, and to find that it was all to be burnt for nothing.
We had to chop up a couple of dozen nice new shiny vehicles because we weren't allowed to leave them in the country. And so there was one grand day of 20 hours with myself and three other guys with gas axes chopping up vehicles.
And the show stopped.
We had to make the decision to go onto Happy Feet, which took the best part of 4 years. What is interesting was that even through the Happy Feet and working on other screenplays, the Mad Max story still stayed up like wallpaper around this room. So it was always in my vision. After a while, it somehow just had to be made. Now, in the meantime, Mel hit a lot of that turbulence in his life. We were talking about other cast. One of them, every time he'd come through Sydney, I'd speak to Heath Ledger. There were just conversations about life and if we get Mad Max up again, you know, that he might do it. And of course, Heath was lost to the world. We went to Warner Brothers by now.
When it migrated over here, we were starting with in the hole a bit, as you would say in baseball. We were a couple million dollars worth of work at Fox had to be repaid. But, you know, the studio made a commitment to it.
We were planning to shoot in Broken Hill and other locations around Australia.
Broken Hill is where the movie Road Warrior, which is what everybody sort of imagines when they think of Mad Max, the second film in the trilogy, that's where that was shot. It's barren, fantastic-looking desert with red rocks and sand.
So we opened a workshop, started to assemble the process again.
Stand there like a machine. You got a machine gun? Yeah. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, thank you.
You'd be not so tall.
That's great, thank you.
We built everything to a certain level there, and then at the same time went to Broken Hill and put in what we called an airstrip, which gave us a nice, wide, long, high-speed run area of packed earth for us to do a lot of the tests.
We had most of the movie cast. We had Tom Hardy, Charlize Theron, we had Hughie's Byrne, and many, many of the cast, and we were ready to shoot in Broken Hill. We had all the vehicles built, all the stunts rehearsed. We had everything ready to go, and then we got rained out of Broken Hill. shoot Mad Max, not only aesthetically, but we couldn't drive across it.
It was sort of a biblical Old Testament rain that hit Australia.
The red expanses of desert that went out to the horizon suddenly became a bit fuzzy. And then as we looked further and further, we realized that it was suddenly turning green.
It was beautiful. It was green rolling hills. It actually looked like Ireland.
I'll never forget the day when Doug sent us photos of the blooming desert.
Beautiful. But for our film, it was you know, the kiss of death.
The studio said, we'll wait and see what happens and see if it dries out, but it didn't dry out.
We basically had to put everything back in storage.
There are things that are always going to go contrary to the plans, and you have to be able to adjust to that. Mad Max Fury Road was probably a heightened version of that.
What was funny about the choice to go to Namibia was, as we're considering it and we're sort of running all the numbers or something, Doug is meanwhile loading cars onto a ship because we have to take them all the way there, and it's going to take 6 to 8 weeks to get them there, or even more than that, I think. So he's like taking phone calls going, yeah, we should consider the Namibian possibility really professionally. Meanwhile, cars are being loaded onto a boat.
The concept of shooting anything in Africa was very difficult. There's been a big expense already by Warner Brothers and Village Roadshow in getting the film this far.
On every movie, you always go in having a budget and a schedule. Those two lines are converging. They're gonna hit, and on the day, first day of photography, you better have brought those things, the budget and the schedule, into line with what your goals are, and you better do it before you get started.
I agreed to contract the shooting period, and that required us ultimately to reduce the schedule from what was equivalent to, say, 140 days down to 100. That's a massive adjustment.
Namibia, I described to somebody as far away as you can possibly go without getting on a spaceship. The basic resources necessary to make a movie don't exist there. There really isn't a crew. Everything had to be brought in. And then because, you know, we were going to be out in a remote location, we had to bring in enough supplies and enough tents and enough, you know, construction vehicles necessary to build roads so that we could bivouac the production out miles from, you know, from a normal civilization.
Taken on something that was humongous. We had something in the region of 1,150 people.
Of people who all painted white or got bits hanging out, babies over their genitals. It was war rigs and this sort of Halloween party that was going on. In the middle of nowhere.
The next time I come on the set, every fapper with a shaved head presents. Thank you.
Yes, Daddy.
Yes, Daddy.
Daddy loves you.
Immorta! Immorta!
And then this compound of, like, very strange...
War boy!
Half-naked people. Just weird.
Itsy Witsy Spider climbed up the water spout. Down came the rain and washed the spider out. Out came the sun and dried up all the rain. Itsy Witsy Spider climbed up the spout again.
There were splatterings of genius even at that stage in what was there. But there was a lot of anxiety, there was a lot of stress attached. Obviously, we've got this mandate that we started the shoot, which was, how do we shoot this thing 40 days lighter than the ones that we did scheduled? We were scrambling every day.
Don't shoot the green bits. No green bits after the apocalypse.
George always says, making a movie is like going into battle. This was our little crucible.
There was some crazy stuff going on in there. I mean, watch the film. You know, everything that you see happened.
So we had 150 vehicles. Stunts.
The most negative feeling I felt on the film, and it was almost every day, was that sense of anxiety that we were doing big stunts every day. And unless we were really on top of our game, somebody could get hurt, and badly. And that wasn't just for patches of time, it was every day, because this, you know, is a very intense action movie. The film invades every waking moment and your dreams. So that was the overwhelming feeling of that anxiety that really kind of ate into you.
George had to get through some really tough days as a filmmaker. He wasn't expecting, you know, to have to handle the actors in the way that actually happened. And that started another whole saga, you know. We thought it was going to be fine, but it was just the start of another war.
We had two different people playing characters who were antagonistic in a very, very arduous situation, and I think that crept into the work.
Even if you don't believe that material affects you, it's an impossible notion. When you're living something and doing something for 8 months straight, it just is under your skin. And I think it was impossible not to have that. I think there were days on the shoot where Tom and I felt that way towards each other.
The simple attrition of working on a long film day after day, where almost every day is a big stunt day. It was physically arduous.
There were bad moments, and there were hard moments, and there were emotional moments.
You're getting close to living the fiction of the movie, and days are really tough. I know it sounds cliche to say, but anybody there sort of starts getting reduced to the kind of creature that would be in that movie.
I think you can kind of endure anything for 4 months or 5 months, and then past that, you just kind of lose your mind, you know? I think that was overwhelming for me.
There was insecurity there as to what their character was and, you know, and his process. They needed more dialogue. They needed ways to express who they were. And they didn't totally understand how he was covering it all. There was an emotional strain.
We didn't have a script as such. We did. There was a script. There was a 130-plus page script. But alongside the script was a storyboard comic book that had frame by frame of everything you see in the movie. From the first day that I saw this comic book to the day I saw the final cut,
there is nothing that has strayed from the visual image of the comic book that George had drawn up years before he got to the set. Nothing was deviated from at all. No matter how we tried to move it, no matter how we tried to work stuff out, bring something to it, he batted carefully everything with due diligence and kindness and understanding into his pictures.
And that's exactly what he got.
Tom needs to feel very, very safe. I think all actors do, particularly taking on a big leading role, because in many ways he's a character actor. And I think he lost trust in the process.
I don't think he understood that style of filmmaking where, you know, there are all these little moments that will come together in the cutting room, a montage style. I think he'd been used to being able to run with a whole scene and feel it out, and it really wasn't that kind of film.
I don't think I'm doing it right. But I think all of us struggled with it in the beginning because you kind of, you doubt that you can get something across without the use of words. And it's good to sometimes be forced into a direction where you're out of your comfort zone. And we were definitely all out of our comfort zone.
I just really wanted to understand what he wanted. And I just completely failed.
Every film is hard to make, but sun and wind and sand is exhausting, you know, no matter what the temperature is. And you've got all the politics of humans interacting with humans, so it was tough for all of us.
If you sort of let everyone else's worry and anxieties and indeed panic get in the way of it, you're not going to be able to do your job well. Pay no mind to the thunder and listen to the birds. There's always thunder in life as well, but listen to the birds, listen to the important things. The decision was made, though, to get out of Africa as soon as possible.
When George came back from Namibia, he was damn exhausted. It was a tough shoot, much more than he'll ever say. It was difficult for him to come back in here and face his material because he wondered whether he had got the film. And I knew that, so it was hard for him. He had to confront his footage.
You really don't know everything that's going on. You don't know how all the pieces of the mosaic are going to fit together. It's only when you've gone through the process can you figure it out.
Those first 3 or 4 months for me were really difficult. We proceeded very slowly. The way that George and I work in the cutting room is reiterative. He loves to experiment. You know, I would never say to George, oh, you know, I've tried that, it doesn't work. You'd never, never say that. He wants to see everything. Because if you've missed something or a great moment, you know, you never hear the end of it. With this amount of material, there were so many options. You know, you felt that you had to explore all the options. I didn't have a problem with that. But to be honest, it can be exhausting.
George is like one of these people that doesn't give up and he's able to, you know, push extra hard and just nudges it harder. When everybody else has gone home, George is still nudging it, you know, and it can be very, very frustrating for, I think, people like Margie have great tolerance.
That level of detail on this film did matter. We squeezed every bit of juice out of that material that they'd shot in Namibia.
No
normal process at a studio is to test a film, that is to put it up in front of audiences in its unfinished form and get feedback in terms of scores and, you know, objective scores or subjective assessments of the film, knowing that it's not done. You know, you're not, it's not the final movie, so you have to project out a bit.
Testing of films is very, very valuable, providing you know what to take from them. I don't think there's much point in testing a movie until it's relatively close to completion. We cut the film without the bookend, the beginning at the Citadel and the end at the Citadel. So for a film like this, until all the pieces were together, it was very, very hard to read.
A lot of the first test audience screening said there was too much action and they couldn't handle it.
Doof Warrior, who was so popular, a certain percentage of the audience said, what the hell is that guy doing? He's annoying.
The fact that Max didn't speak much. People wanted him to speak. Why didn't he speak? And why couldn't you hear what he was saying? For the end chase, you know, a lot of people just said, oh, enough already, more cars, you know, bashing into each other. Like, what were they smoking in that cutting room?
And so you walk away and, you know, your job here is to go, look, I've been an advocate of this movie for what seems like forever. I've been an advocate of this director since going back to Happy Feet. Do we have something here that's salvageable?
They are incredibly painful because you are trying to cut the film and then there's this pressure. You have a test audience screening and then the studio say, oh, you know, in another 5 weeks, we want another one, where you've responded to all the notes from the previous screening. And that is exhausting. And it's exhausting for the sound crew, for everyone, because you basically just want to cut the film and finish cutting the film, but you never have a chance to finish cutting the film because people are criticizing you before you've finished something. And that can be very destructive, to be honest.
By now, everyone said all the action's there, everything sort of makes sense, but we've got key parts of the story missing.
The next year, we ramped back up again in Australia, and then we did the end crash sequence. With the war rig and the doof machine. We did the entire opening of the film, which is in the Citadel.
That was a big moment because it proved the theory that if all the pieces are allowed to come together, the thing can finally work.
The words you've been waiting for 12 years. That's a wrap. Thank you very much.
Right at the end, George and I decided we don't care what anyone else thinks right now. We didn't ask anyone else's opinion. The two of us sat in a cutting room and we decided we'll do what we think is the best thing to do. And that is the film that actually was released.
I say this is my first Comic-Con.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
This is your first Comic-Con?
Yeah. Yeah.
The crowd reaction was phenomenal. You know, I think Twitter started going, like the lights started coming up all over the world.
That was a very, very significant moment in the life of this film.
Khan was extraordinary because for George, for the film to be honored, or just appreciated in that environment, was really, truly special.
Not really sure how people are going to react. And there was a standing ovation, like people were going berserk in the actual screening. I looked across at George and, you know, and they were all standing, and it was like, fuck, something good's happening.
We were just all blown away. We just couldn't believe it, which was so exciting.
George stood up, and I think, and it kept going for a while. It's like, well, what do we do now?
Wasn't until the film was finally cut that Tom and Charlie's, indeed a lot of the cast, realized what I was trying to do. It was until you actually see it in its final form. And that's when Tom, I think it was the Cannes Film Festival, publicly apologized.
I suddenly got what George was talking about, actually, because for 7 months, I think the most complicated piece for me, and the most frustrating thing for me, or the hardest part of it, was trying to know what George wanted me to do at any given minute. I have to apologize to you because I got frustrated. And there was no way that George could have explained what he could see in the sand when we were out there. And because of the due diligence that was required to make everything safe and to make everything, which is incredibly complex, so simple, and what I saw, which is a relentless barrage of complexities simplified. I mean, I knew he was brilliant, but I didn't quite know how brilliant until I saw that. That's my first reaction was, oh my God, I owe George an apology for being so myopic.
I thought it was very, very gracious of you because you finally figured out what I was trying to do.
It was so great to see George validated in that moment.
It took about 10 years before Mad Max 1 and Mad Max 2, I realized, this movie did mean something to people.
Finally, we finished Fury Road, so I can die happy.
George Miller is a true genius. He's a magician.
There's a lot of lovely reviews coming back from around the world.
He's pulled it off. End of story.
The fact that right up to the Academy Awards that you know, people seem to be responding to what we had done.
There's so many occasions I thought, this is never going to get made, this is never going to happen. So this is just all sort of surreal and sort of just totally a bonus. It's connected with an audience, and I love the fact that all the crew are getting acknowledged. That's the great thing.
You know, somehow we got through all those obstacles, and besides that, an amazing film was made.
We won 6 awards in a row, which became kind of heady and out of control, and some of the people that were working with, even Steven Spielberg, was sitting 3 feet rows ahead of me, and I had been working with him, so, and he loves the movie and he loves George, and he even turned around and did a thumbs up. I mean, it was like, that was an amazing little run there.
It's the highest Academy Award winning film ever made in Australia.
When Margaret won her Oscar, I was so like happy.
I'm still kind of amazed. Did that actually happen?
I'm proudest of having dragged my little bit across the desert and through the jaws of death to actually get to the other side.
I truly believe now that Fury Road will be held up as the way to do action for the new cinema.
I'm very grateful for having got out of that one alive, tell you the truth. But am I proud of what happened? Yeah, you know, it's probably one of the things in my life that is the pinnacle of sort of the career that I've been in.
I'm just incredibly happy for all those people that dedicated so many years to this project, including George. You know, that ultimately we weren't deluded, that we actually did know what we were doing.
It means that you're more right than you are wrong, which is always a good feeling. That for all of us, that's what life's about. We don't really understand the real purpose of our existence, except to be in existence and do things and try to examine the world through your work and through the way you conduct yourself in life. I just have a sense that I've learned something in my time.
Thanks, Corey. Thank you.
I don't know if people will still be thinking about it or referring to it in 30 years. The lady who came up to me, this fine young woman who said, look, I've just had a baby girl and I've called her Furiosa. And I thought, wow. And I said, why? She said, because I wanted her to grow up strong. You have a sense that the movie will stay in some people's minds for quite some time. At least there's one little girl who will grow up with the name Furiosa. She'll probably want to change her name. She'll probably say, why did you call me Furiosa? I want to be called Jenny.